Hello friends, today's video will be our third chapter. This chapter is on Vedic civilization. After the Harappan age comes the Vedic age or the Vedic civilization. The people of the age are called Aryans. We know about the Vedic culture mainly from the Vedas and other texts of that time. Vedic civilization can further be classified into two parts. Early Vedic civilization, which lasted from 1500 to 1000 BCE, and the later Vedic civilization, which lasted from 1100 to 500 BCE. We know about the early Vedic civilization from the Rig Veda. Similarly, we know about the later Vedic civilization from different texts like Samaveda, Yajurveda, Atharvaveda, Brahmanas, Aranyakas, and Upanishads. We will discuss about these texts in detail in the coming lecture. So to start with Vedic civilization, let us start with early Vedic civilization. We know that Aryans are the main people of the Vedic civilization. But where did these Aryans come from? There are different theories on how Aryans came to India. The main three theories are the European theory, Central Asian theory, and the Indian theory. The European theory says that the Aryans came from Europe, which was their actual home. If we compare the languages of Europe and the Indian language, Sanskrit, there are many similarities in words and their pronunciations also. The next theory is called the Central Asian theory. This theory says that Aryans originally lived in Central Asia, from where they moved and invaded India. Archaeologists are convinced with this theory because there are linguistic similarities between Central Asian languages and the Indian languages. For example, the word Asura is pronounced as Hasura in Central Asian language. The difference in this word is just the letter H. The next theory is the Indian theory, which says that Aryans did not come from somewhere, but they were the natives of India. This theory also suggests that Sanskrit was the mother of all languages. Now the question is, which of these theories is correct? Archaeologists using modern tools came to a conclusion that Aryans came from the now Siberian region. Archaeologists also rejected the invasion theory. According to them, Aryans migrated from southern Siberia to India. In this map, we can see where Aryans settled. The brown color region is where the early Vedic civilization flourished. The earliest Aryans settled down here, which is now eastern Afghanistan, Punjab, and Uttar Pradesh. Now that we have seen where Aryans settled, one big question anyone has is, how do we know about the early Vedic civilization? Early Vedic civilization is known to us from the Rig Veda. Rig Veda is a part of the Vedas. Vedas are divided into four parts as Rig Veda, Samaveda, Yajurveda, and Atharva Veda. Early Vedic period is mentioned in the Rig Veda, which is the oldest of the four Vedas. Rig Veda contains Sanskrit hymns praying God like Agni, Indra, Mitra, Surya, etc. There are 1028 hymns present in the Rig Veda. These hymns are also called Rigs. From this word, this part of the Vedas was called Rig Veda. Rig Veda later on turned to Rig Veda. One speciality of the Rig Veda is the Gayatri Mantra composed by Vishwamitra, which is played in many homes, is from the Rig Veda itself. The other three parts of the Vedas which we discussed earlier, the Samaveda, Yajurveda, and the Atharva Veda, that we'll be discussing in this lecture itself in the coming slides. Now that we have seen the sources of early Vedic civilization, let us now look at the features of the early Vedic civilization. In this video, we will discuss six important features of the early Vedic civilization. We will discuss about religious practices at that time, social practices, position of women, administration, agriculture, and economy of that time. Starting with religion, there were no temples found that belong to that period. Also from texts, we know that there was no idol worship present. But this does not mean that the then people did not believe in God. Instead, they worshipped natural forces like water, wind, fire, etc. People also killed animals during sacrifices. However, killing of cow was not allowed. It was prohibited. In fact, people prayed to God for sons and cattle. The next feature of the early Vedic civilization is their social practices. From the texts, we came to know that Varna system existed during that time. However, this Varna system is based on color of the person. Fair-skinned people were called Aryavarna, while the dark-skinned people were called Dasvarna. Coming to the concept of marriages, most of the marriages were monogamous. That means a person has a single mate at a single point of time. However, there are instances of polyandry and polygyny too. Polyandry is a marriage setup in which a woman has more than one husband, while polygyny is where a man has more than one wife. Also, widows were allowed to marry again. There was no sati system present at this time and child marriages were not performed. Coming to position of women, we have already discussed some points in social practices. Other features are that society at this time was divided based on gender. The early Vedic society was mostly male dominated, which means patriarchal. There were taboos around menstruating women during this time. Despite all these taboos and male domination, women were allowed to enter assemblies where important administration subjects were discussed. The next topic is administration. The early Vedic period was a tribal society, which is similar to monarchy. However, the king did not have unlimited powers. Also, the king's posts is not hereditary. Anyone found fit to the post was selected as king. The tribal chief was called Rajan, queen was called Mahisi, and people were called Janas. Knowing these words is important from prelims point of view. The king or Rajan was also called Gopati. Gopati means the protector of cows. From this word, we can come to know how much importance the Vedic people gave to protecting cows. Coming to agriculture, wooden plow was used at that point of time. Also, shifting agriculture was practiced. Shifting agriculture is a form of agriculture in which an area of ground is cleared of vegetation and cultivated for a few years and then abandoned for a new area until its fertility has been naturally restored. The early Vedic texts mention only barley. This is probably because barley was their only staple food. Now, coming to economy of the early Vedic civilization, the then people mainly depended on cattle rearing. A wealthy man was not someone who owned large lands or money. A rich person was a person who owned more cattle. Once again, this stresses the fact that they gave utmost importance to cows. Also, there was no concept of private property. Everything was communal. During this time, priests were given gifts. Gifts were not given in money or land form. Cows and women slaves were gifted to priests. Okay, now let us discuss the later Vedic civilization. The map you see on your screen is of the later Vedic civilization. Now, by this time, Indo-Aryans moved to the northern parts of India. However, the Gangetic plains remained out of bounds to the Vedic tribes because of thick forest cover. By the end of the Vedic period, several tribal kingdoms were formed. The Kuru kingdom, which you see on your screen, was the first Vedic state formed by the then tribes. While discussing early Vedic civilization, we discussed that the source of the Vedic civilization was the Rig Veda, which is a part of the Vedas. Now, for later Vedic civilization, the sources are the remaining three Vedas along with other scriptures. So, in total, the sources of later Vedic period are Samveda, Yajurveda, Atharvaveda, Brahmanas, Aranyakas and Upanishads. Starting with Samveda, the Samveda has two major parts. The first part includes four melody collections and the second part three verse books. Just as in the Rigveda, the early sections of Samveda typically begin with hymns to Agni and Indra but shift to the abstract later on. In the Samveda, some of the Rigvedic verses are repeated. Now coming to Yajurveda, Yajurveda is a compilation of ritual offering formulas that was said by priests while an individual performed ritual actions such as those before the Yajna fire. It consists of prose mantras. The Yajurveda has been the primary source of information about sacrifices during Vedic times and associated rituals. The Atharvaveda, on the other hand, was not considered as a Veda in the Vedic era and was accepted as a Veda in late 1st millennium BCE. It was compiled last amongst all Vedas. The Atharvaveda is sometimes called the Veda of magical formulas. The text also includes hymns dealing with the two major rituals, marriage and cremation. Now coming to Brahmanas, these contain the commentary on the hymns of the Vedas. In short, they explain the Vedic rituals mentioned in the Vedas. For example, first chapter of Chandogya Brahmana, one of the oldest Brahmanas, talks about the ceremony of marriage and rituals at the birth of a child. Aranyakas, on the other hand, talk about the philosophy behind the rituals mentioned in the Vedas. Upanishads, on the other hand, are very important. They are placed at the end of the Vedas, so they are called Vedanta. It contains the philosophy of life. Upanishads are not to be confused with Aranyakas. Aranyakas talk about the philosophy of rituals, while Upanishads talk about the philosophy of life. Upanishads are 108 in number. Upanishads do not stress on rituals. The philosophy of Upanishads was taken into Buddhism and Jainism also. One important thing is that Bhagavad Gita is also a part of the Vedanta. Okay, so now we will look at the features of the post-Vedic period. We'll look at religion, social practices, position of women, administration, pottery, and economy. Starting with religion, during this post-Vedic phase, the animal sacrifices became common. Also, the fire rituals increased and the yajnas also increased. However, Indra and Agni, these two gods, were given less importance in this phase. If you see the previous phase, the pre-Vedic phase, during that time Indra was given a lot of importance. Next thing is new gods gained importance, example like Vishnu and Rudra. So these are two important gods of this post-Vedic phase. Also, the idol worship increased. People started worshipping idols. Next, however, this idol worship decreased during the final stages of post-Vedic phase. There was strong resistance to idol worship at the end of the Vedic period, and thus the Upanishads were written. If you see the Upanishads, in the Upanishads also the rituals are given less importance. And coming to social practices, during this phase the Varna system, four Varna system emerged. The hierarchy goes as the topmost hierarchy is Brahmanas, then Kshatriyas, then Vaishyas and then Shudras. Shudras were given less importance in the society and they were discriminated. And this social hierarchy became rigid during this phase itself. And the Brahmanas became more powerful and they dictated the other three hierarchical systems. Also during this post-Vedic phase, rituals increased. People started performing more pujas. And caste and gotra became more prominent during this phase. And also, man and woman with same gotra were not allowed to marry, and this is still applicable in India. A man and woman of the same gotra cannot be married even till today. And coming to position of women, the status of women decreased in the society. They were confined to household chores and they were deprived to attend assemblies. They were even deprived of education, and child marriages became more common. If you see the post-Vedic phase and the pre-Vedic phase, in the pre-Vedic phase, women were given good social status and child marriages were not common. However, in the post-Vedic phase, the child marriages became common. In pre-Vedic phase, it was not this common. However, there was still no sati system, and a daughter is considered to be a source of sorrow. If you see the sati system, even in the first phase and the later phase also, it's not present. Then comes the administration. In the post-Vedic phase, taxes were made mandatory, and a person who collected taxes was he was given a name, and that name is Sangrihitri. So he was called by that name. Kingship, hereditary kingship started emerging. That means a king's son is also a king after the king's term is over. So this hereditary process started in this post-Vedic phase. Coming to pottery, this particular phase is famous for painted graveware. If you see the image, this is the type of pottery present at that point of time, and this period is also called the Iron Age Indian culture. And if you notice the pottery, you'll find that the pottery is highly standardized pottery, and though it was highly standardized, very limited decoration was used. Very little decoration was made on this pottery. And coming to economy, urbanization started at this phase. Though urbanization started and trade increased, but still people depended on agriculture. And during this phase, plow was also used for cultivation, and rice and wheat became staple foods. So these are the main features of the post-Vedic phase. Okay friends, so this is all about the pre-Vedic phase and the post-Vedic phase. In total, it is called the Vedic phase. So in the next chapter, we'll discuss about Buddhism, and after that, we'll discuss about Jainism. So if you like this video, please do subscribe to my channel and please do like the video. Thank you.